And that's a great point when you talk about the author ego and having to have your work edited or have someone say this is not quite yet ready. And what do you advise authors clearly you're saying that they should maybe handle it a little bit better than many of them are. But I tend to tell people that that's a good thing when they can get constructive criticism. But how do you coach people to handle feedback from editors or even agents or yourself that maybe, you know, saying this is not quite ready yet?
Well, I once went to an opening of a movie that I produced with the director at the Fort Lauderdale Film Festival, and after it was the opening film in the festival because they liked it so much, everybody came up to him afterwards and wanted to congratulate him, shake his hand, but he spent most of the time after the movie talking to this crotchety old guy who was filled with criticisms of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And he was listening to him intently. And I finally I was amazed. And long story short is, in a couple of hours later, we were sitting on the beach at midnight looking at the water, and I said, you have the most amazing tolerance for criticism of any artist I've ever met. And he said, it's the only way I learn. You know, people telling you you're wonderful or that your work is great, I don't learn anything from them. I mean, it's nice, but I can learn when somebody has something critical to say. And I just thought that was the most wonderful attitude you could possibly have toward someone who's giving you criticism, whether they're well-intentioned or not, didn't make any difference to him. He just listened to what they were saying, some of which he rejected, but other of which might have been good points to make him a little better artist on his next movie.
Yeah,
and I just think that honest criticism is so rare in a business where people are so busy that when you get it and treat it with anything other than gratitude, you are making a huge and probably irreversible mistake with that particular person.
I wanted to ask you quickly another question before I opened up the call to our listeners on the phone. You mentioned earlier when we were talking about the mid-list authors to have a good high concept. Can you define what a high concept is and maybe how the writers on the phone can maybe think about incorporating that into the projects they're working on?
Well, a high concept is a concept that is so obvious and so instantly understandable that you do not have to explain it.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes the title does it by itself. We had a book that we published called Fire with Fire, in which a man whose wife and kids were killed by a terrorist in a bombing goes after them and tracks them down and brings them to justice. And I just thought, that's a high concept, Fire with Fire.
Mm-hmm.
You know, movies with high concept, Bruce Almighty, and
mm-hmm.
you hear that Jim Carrey's playing with it, you know, playing in it, and you realize that it's a story in which an ordinary man gets to be God. But Bruce Almighty sort of says it all right there. You don't have to spend half an hour on the phone with a friend explaining to them what the movie's about. They get it. Liar, liar. That's a high concept. You know the high concepts when you see them because they're you're instantly going, why didn't I write that? Oh, my God, that's so obvious.
Right, right. Now, but on the other hand, on the flip side of that, and while I'm asking this question, I'll ask those who are on the phone to go ahead and unmute because I am going to open up the call to you to ask your questions after this one. But on the flip side of that, how do you come up with a high concept that then is not a cliche? Because I think many new writers run the danger of the concept being so common or so easily recognizable that then it almost becomes a cliche. So how do you avoid that?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, you have to know your work. I mean, one of the things that always strikes me as very bizarre is how many new, you know, wannabe writers, would-be writers, don't read books. And
mm-hmm.
so they really don't even know what they're writing. You know, they start out with the thought, well, anybody can write a romance novel, so I can do it too. But they don't read romance novels. They don't even know who the big authors are in the very field that they're going to and haven't read their work. Well, that's how you write cliches, is by acting that way.
Mm-hmm.
The way you don't have cliches is you read in the world you're going into and you say, oh, my goodness, what if this happened? And I just sold a book yesterday that is an absolutely amazing high concept. I won't tell you what it is because it's one of the signs of a high concept is it can be easily stolen because it's so obvious, you know.
Right.
But when this comes out, people are going to look at it, oh, my God, I had no idea, and I should have written that.
Okay. So it's easily recognizable that it could be a cliche, but it's told in a way where it's not, and yet people get it instantly, and that's what makes a hit movie or the best-selling book, that type of thing.
Yeah, I mean, that's a very good way to summarize it, and one of the things you should do the minute you have the idea is to start looking on Amazon and looking on the Internet and seeing if you find it. If you don't find 1,000 examples of it, then maybe you're on to something that is an original high concept.
Okay, great.
And, you know, nothing is ever completely original. We all know that.
Right.
But it's like this one hasn't been done for a long time.
Right, right. Okay, well, I'm going to open it up for our callers on the line. If you all have questions for Dr. Attidy, feel free to jump in. Don't be shy. Maybe share your name and then ask your question. No takers?
Don't be shy.
No takers? Okay, well, you guys are going to have to let me make sure that you have your phone unmuted now. I think it's, let's see, star 2 lets you raise your hand. I have you unmuted on my line, so I'm not sure how you would unmute it on your end if you use the system. I think it's #6. But if you are on the line, feel free to jump in and ask a question. I'll just ask a few more questions while we're waiting on you all. Let's see. Maybe tell us about one of your recent new clients that you know, of course, somebody whose project that you are able to talk about and how they engaged you, what made their work intriguing to you and made you feel like this was something you could sell.
Well, I have a book is about to come out called The Trial, and the R on the cover has the RX sign, you know, the sign of a prescription drug.
Yes.
So it's a legal thriller ending in a trial, but it's about a drug trial. And there's an example of a, you know, high concept that was unbelievable when Larry Thompson came up with the idea. I mean, I looked immediately on Amazon, and to my astonishment, nobody had published a legal thriller called The Trial. I mean, not even Grisham. So that was a great title. 4 book clubs picked it up, probably based on the title alone. And what attracted me to Larry in the first place is that he had self-published a book called So Help Me God, which is another legal term, and went out there and promoted it. And we ended up selling, you know, the book to a traditional publisher, and they brought it out. And then he came up with a trial, and I just was so impressed that he was taking the things he knows the most, which is his knowledge of the law, and turning them into stories, and then following through and improving his craft and taking every criticism that he got to heart and figuring out if he agreed with it or not and implementing it if he did or discussing it if he didn't. I just was so impressed by his professionalism. I just thought, this guy is going to be a winner. I don't know how long it's going to take. It might be forever, but, you know, I don't think so. I think he's going to be a winner in our lifetimes, you know. And he just works. He's a workhorse, and his wife, Vicki, is behind him at every step to provide marketing ideas. They're doing contests and awards and, you know, going on speaking tours and bookstores set up. I mean, there's an unending amount of energy is pouring into this. So he also got 9 or 10 blurbs from people like Jim Rollins and Steve Barry, big writers. And how did he do that? He jumped on a plane and went to writers' conferences and you know, cornered them and talked to them and got them to agree to read his manuscript. And I think his batting average was about 100%.
That's really awesome. And so what I hear is that legwork, that commitment to not just producing the book, but he put in some time beforehand, like you mentioned, the writers' conferences, which I say to every aspiring author, I mean, you've got to do 2 or 3. You know, that's just sort of your networking vehicle. But he put in the work beforehand, and now he's got a strategy in place to help promote that book. He's not just sort of handing the baby off to you and to the publisher saying, hey, make this fly. He's actually putting in some energy himself.
Exactly. And that, you know, that attracts me.
That's great. That's great. What about a nonfiction author that you've worked with who's done really well?
Well, nonfiction is easier to sell, and our biggest success, our recent success, was the Kennedy Detail, which came out last November, and we were able to produce it as a movie, so it came out on the Discovery Channel the same month the book came out. and that was written by a secret, you know, a retired Secret Service agent, and who interviewed the six or seven survivors who were on JFK's detail, and we put one of my clients with him to write the book, and they went on a speaking tour, and we hit the New York Times list, and you know, had the movie going, and it was extremely exciting. And now we've sold one of the other agents' book, Clint Hill, who guarded Jackie Kennedy. Now we've sold his book to the same publisher, and they're gearing up to do a big campaign for that book as well. So nonfiction is great because it's something the publishers know how to sell more easily than fiction. You know, fiction by Stephen King or James Patterson, they know how to sell that.
Right.
But it's the problem with, you know, new writers who don't have those big names yet is that the publisher doesn't have a way, unless the writer has built a platform, doesn't have a way of promoting them.
Right, exactly, exactly. That's great. And I read a great review about the Kennedy detail, so I'm looking forward to reading that book and also seeing the documentary. So, you know, congrats on that.
Thank you.
Do our listeners have any questions at this point? Again, this is your opportunity. This is great practice for those writers' conferences.
Everybody shy tonight?
I think so. Dawn, did you have a question? Or Gina? Or Mary? Okay. No one's going to speak up tonight. Well, I guess I'll just ask you a final question then, and what we'll do is I'll just make sure that they get the recording afterwards. So I guess my final question to you is, you know, what is your sort of, you know, when you're speaking at writers' conferences or you're sort of trying to quickly share an overview about what this business is like with people, what do you say to them would be like the top three things that they need to make sure that they have in their repertoire that they are doing to at least get them moving in the right direction? Because, of course, there are many more things that they'll have to do. But what are like the top three things you'd advise them to do?
Well, the first one is to learn the craft of writing. And never give up. I mean, study writers every day, writers who are better than you are. One of the best ways to learn is simply to read the bestsellers in your field. So number one is learning. And number two is persistence. Never put a deadline on your career. Be determined that you're going to succeed no matter how long it takes you. Move forward. And the number three thing is networking, I would guess. Making sure that you get out there to conferences and to places where you can meet editors, meet agents, meet literary managers, meet producers, meet attorneys. The more you do of that, the easier it's going to be, because then you realize that people are willing to help, and you aren't going to do this without other people's help. So the sooner you get into the network of people who are doing it, the sooner you're going to move forward too.
Exactly, exactly. Great, great advice. Anything? Is there anything you'd like to add that I haven't thought to ask you this evening?
Well, yeah, I think that, you know, we've talked about the difficulties, and the biggest thing I like to add is that the world remains insatiable for stories, that stories will never get to the point where people don't want them anymore. It's just a bigger challenge today than ever before for the storyteller to find his or her way to the market. But don't worry, the market is there, and it's hungrier than ever. And once they found you, it's difficult. It's as difficult to get out of that loop than it was to get into that loop. So that's what's worth looking forward to, is that, you know, they are looking for you. And what makes it so hard for them to find you is that there are tens of thousands of people in that, you know, clogging up that pipeline who are doing most of what they're doing wrong. Aren't, you know, sending in manuscripts that are properly edited, sending them to the wrong place, not following the rules of their particular genre that they're writing in. All those people have clogged up the pipelines and made it very, very difficult for you to get you a really well-written, well-edited, you know, well-marketed plan to the editor. So never give up, and that's why you go to do the networking, so you aren't just one more book, you know, manuscript in the pipeline, that you actually got a chance to pitch it to somebody in New York and who actually might want to take the time to read it because they met you at a conference in Georgia or in, you know, Seattle or in Hawaii.